So WS policy, first thing we'll look at. The policy specification itself is meant for you to give certain additional characteristics to services that you may wish to deploy. Even security is actually expressed as a policy, it turns out. Right? So policy is actually a framework, it's a grammar to express certain requirements or capabilities that are available. Right? So it applies to a number of other specifications that lie underneath it. We'll see it when we see the architecture of the web service framework. So this is what it looks like. What you'll see is that policy sits almost at the top. So what this is trying to say is that policy is actually expressed in UDDI or WSDL, right? So you'll write policy expressions, as we call it, and that will be expressed even within WSDL documents or within UDDI ST models. So we'll have to keep coming back to some of these concepts. The policies refer to something underneath it. So there may be a reliability policy, there may be a security policy, whatever, right? So which is why it is placed all the way at the top. So WS policy itself just tells you how to write policies without being specific about any policy or any set of policy expressions that may actually refer to a policy about security, you know, reliability and so on, right? So that's the notion here. So it's a very simple, everything obviously is still expressed in XML, that doesn't change for us at all. We'll actually see some of these details. So you say that there is a WS policy, there's some namespace, and you can, so this is a description of a policy, and then you can actually reference this policy from wherever. Right? In the case of UDDI, you can express the policy as a T model and store it within UDDI, and then refer to that even through categorization. So you can say one of the categories is this policy T model that I actually conform with when I express a service, for example. Right? So the basic building blocks are what are called assertions within policies. Right? Assertions, like in programming language assertions, which just say that this has to be true at some point in time. Right? And we'll see some example assertions. The assertions can either be a preference, right? So for people who are asking for it, for example, it can be a preference, it can be a requirement, or from the service provider's perspective, it can be a capability that they are providing. Right? So there is the notion of usage that we will describe within a policy specification, and we'll see a complete policy expression statement. And we actually, what we do is it's organized hierarchically. We collect all of these expressions into a larger entity, and those can be attached to different things. That's the notion, right? So you write a set of policy expressions, you can group policy expressions in some way, and then you can attach this group to something, a service, for example, and so on. Right? So the WSP usage values, are many of them are there, and these can be added. These are the standard ones that that has been given. So the policy is required, it's optional. So this preference notion is expressed this way. It is observed, ignored, whatever. Right? So general messaging assertions can also be written, like you must only send requests in German in this particular example. we'll actually go to see one of these examples. So specific assertions have to do with specific aspects of what the policy is trying to describe, right? So for example, if you're trying to describe security through a policy, then there are security policy assertions, right? So the basic notion there is the notion of a security token, and the token, for example, can represent a user password login notion versus a certificate of some kind that is coming, and so on. And then you can have policy assertions having to do with integrity, confidentiality, visibility, and so on and so forth. Right? So these are all extensible. There are certain standard things that are defined for you up front. So if you're talking about policy assertions having to do with reliable messaging, then it is things like delivery assurance. Is it, for example, at most once, delivery semantics, at least once, things like that. Whether the message expires at certain point in time. There are many of them. Most of these are self-explanatory if you look at the name of this particular assertion itself. Right? So for example, retransmission interval means that if I don't get an acknowledgement back, then after how long should I wait and then retransmit that particular message. right? so this is another assertion about reliable messaging. No, WS policy itself is a language, that's all. A language in XML terms means a set of tags that they give you, right? Now you construct policies out of this, right? There is no default and the policies have to do with some aspect of your service infrastructure, right? Either security or messaging or whatever, right? Or coordination and so on. There is no default policies that can be written for any of these from what I know, but certainly an organization will first set up some of these policies beforehand, right? And these can be published via directory as three models and other people can use them.
So it is not a part of WSDL file?
It can be part of WSDL file too. Remember, WSDL and UDDI are two separate things. You can have WSDL without using UDDI, so you can actually stick it in the WSDL file itself. And I'll show you an example of how you stick it into the WSDL file. Or you can publish it directly into UDDI as a T model and then use it. Right? One of the two ways of using it. Yeah.
Is it so that we can implement these security policies on SOAP server itself?
Yeah, yeah. So the policy doesn't talk about how it is implemented. Remember, all of web services is an interface specification at the end of the day. Right? It is. How do people who use it see it, and what is the provider going to expose, right? How you actually implement that is left up to you, and it's typically a lot of help is provided for the implementation by the engine on which you are going to run this system, right? So if you run it on WebLogic, they will give you a lot of help on implementing certain default policies, for example. They might have created default policies that you can use. Okay, here is an example of a policy. This is a security policy because WS it has something to do with security. This specifically has something to do with integrity. So you can specify the usage as one of those four things. You know, it is required, it is optional, things like that. Then we are saying that we are talking about a security token, which is a Kerberos kind of a token out here. So that means that whatever authentication is going to be done has to accept this Kerberos token that is going to come across, right? That is what you're expressing here as part of a policy. So here's another example of a confidentiality policy. Confidentiality, in this particular case, it has to do with a 509 certificate that is coming across of some form. And here we're just saying that this token is going to be a certificate of this particular kind, right? And this itself would be defined. What does this X509V3 mean would be defined somewhere for you, right? We understand what it means because we understand what 509 means, but for the system to understand, it has to be described someplace. So policy operators is this notion of grouping that I talked about earlier. So you set up a bunch of assertions and then you can group them in some way and call it a policy operator. It's just so that there is a notion of reuse that is available here because policy assertions might be reusable in different groups and people may combine different sets of assertions for different purposes. Right? So that's the only reason why they've done this. There's nothing special about this. Huh? Then it's up to you to deal with it. You should not be actually, because a service provider, for example, let's say you're a service provider, right? You're the one defining policies for accessing that service, right? So if you are going to define two different policies which are going to conflict with each other, that is going to be your issue. It is, the system will be, it's highly unlikely that the system can automatically detect and resolve conflicts of any kind. So even detection is very, very hard, right? Because the semantics of this are not specified. This is only an interface. So if I, as a service provider, say that for authentication, I require a X509 certificate, and then you also stick another policy saying for authentication, I require a username password, then how can the system make out?
The policy framework that you mentioned in your first slide must be giving some direction
of this. The WS policy language doesn't give you any way of setting up an ordering. Specifically, all it says is that you can specify these policies, right? For a particular, how that policy will actually be executed is really part of the implementation of that, and I'm not sure there's a standard for that. From what I know, there isn't, but let me verify that. Right? So different people may implement it in different ways. So this is one way by which it gives you certain amount of control. When you create a group, you can say only one in the group have to be executed, right? Or all of the assertions in the group are applicable to whatever it is being attached to, right? So these are some of the three operators that have been given for you, or one or more of them are available. So it's not exactly ordering, but it'll allow you to say that I can only pick one if there are two conflicting policies that are in there. All it's saying is I will accept any one of them. In other words, I can do security authentication either via a 509 certificate or via username password, right? It doesn't matter which is given, I'll take either one of them. So that's what exactly one would mean, right? So here, in fact, that's the example that's here as well. It says that here's a policy operator, which is a collection of two different policy assertions. This is one of the assertions, this is the second assertion. The first assertion says that, you know, I'm going to take a username token, username password type of authentication. The second one says I'm going to take a certificate to do authentication. And exactly one of these would be accepted. And if both of them came along, obviously there would be an issue and they may not agree with each other. What if one authentication, the other doesn't? That would be an issue. So I'm telling you that in part of the specification, I will only take one of these. You can't send both.
Suppose this username is taken, therefore in order to use this policy, the user
must
get registered first.
That's obvious, right? So you got to have an account, in other words. If you don't have an account, you will not be able to access this service. But how you set up the account is not part of the policy declaration part of it. It has nothing to do with that, right? The policy is just saying how do you access the service in terms, you know, what are the conditions that I'm going to put on this for you to access the service. Okay, so attachment is this notion of simply associating the policy with some subject, whatever it happens to be, a web service in our case. So this is how you do it in WSDL. So there are different, basically everything is a URI. Remember we've talked about this before as well. Because in WSDL there is no notion of T-model, right? So that's a UDDI concept. Just in WSDL, there's no such notion. So I will say that this lookup response message is associated with some policy which can be found at this URI that I'm specifying here. And the policy URI itself is specified separately. And when you hit that URI, the description of the policy will be available there. Right? The same thing is being true. You can attach different policies for different parts of the message as well that are out there. So here is a notion of this being expressed as a T model. So the policy itself is available at some URL. The URL is given the overview documentation, just like we would give the WSDL URL as part of the overview documentation in the WSDL T model, right? So here we are saying that this is a policy expression. It's out there, some name is going to be given, and it's some category bag that this policy might also be attached to, right? So in other words, the policy itself may be part of security policies that I'm going to have. So security may be a category bag that I'm setting up in here, right? Now what will happen is when you store a service description in here, let's say you're going to store a WSDL within UDDI, then this itself would, this T model itself can be referred to as a category for that particular service description that is being put in here. Which means that if you're searching for services which will accept X509 certificates, then that's a category, and then you'll probably pick up that service if it is attached to that as through the T model relationship. Right? You get what that means. Remember, everything in UDDI is a T model, eventually. Anything concrete, and the actual policy description is a concrete description. So there are some tools that are available to help you deal with this. I'm not going to go into this, but a couple of tools that I wanted to mention. Because yesterday a number of questions came up as to what are the tools, privately at least, what are the tools that I should be using for some of these things. So. Almost every enterprise vendor has tools in this space. That's the bottom line, right? The major enterprise vendors, of course, are IBM, Microsoft, Oracle, WebLogic. Is WebLogic being bought by Oracle? Does anybody know? There was some news in the papers. I thought I saw sometime. Pardon?
Open source tools
are there, certainly. I'm talking of vendors specifically. Red Hat has taken over JBoss now. So you can actually get support from Red Hat if you want to use JBoss as an open source environment. So that's a good thing, actually. Okay. So it's an overview of the policy aspect of it. We'll go over addressing next. The notion of WS addressing is to basically not tie the transport protocol as part of the endpoint specification. I'll show you what I mean by this. And to enable asynchronous communication. The asynchronous communication is the key here, and we'll see examples of how this can be done as well. Right, so here is an example of a SOAP message. There are three parts to this. I'm going to do a post on this SOAP message, right? So this is, I'm using HTTP to send this. So the host URL is given here, and the fact that this message is of type SOAP is given here, right? And what is the SOAP action to be performed is another URL. So in other words, you got to hit this SOAP message has to be sent to this particular person, some kind of an object that is going to receive this and do something about it. In this case, it is a method that is going to be executed somewhere, get stock price method, right? So that is the SOAP action. So what we have done here is we have made all this dependent on the actual transport protocol of HTTP that we are using. So in here is another HTTP message that this is referring to, and so on. We'll see how we want to do this as opposed to this, right? In order to make the SOAP message itself be protocol neutral, what we want to do is to wrap some of this HTTP specific information with some WSA tags that we've been given, right? So that can actually be replaced with something else. So this is actually not part of the SOAP message itself now, right? What we are saying is that this notion of get stock price, which is a SOAP action, right, which was described separately here as a SOAP action as part of the HTTP header. So now I'm actually mixing the fact that the SOAP action is part of the HTTP header. Therefore, I am tying myself into HTTP intimately in this, right? So this is what's happening. Even though it's an HTTP binding that is being used, what we are doing is we are mixing the SOAP aspects of it and the HTTP aspects of it into one, because this SOAP action is really shouldn't be here, it should be somewhere in here in the SOAP envelope itself, right? So it should say that this is the method that is to be called eventually, right? So this is how you would do it using WS addressing, and this will give you transport protocol neutrality. So this would simply be a HTTP post to some URL. Right, so in this case the URL would be www.stock.org, and you would send a SOAP message to that, and then within there, when it parses the WS addressing headers, it knows that it has to go to get stock price, which would actually be the action, and this would have to be sent to some object that would take care of this action. Right, so do you see the difference between this and this? So the basic notion here is that So this part of it is the SOAP envelope. This is the SOAP message that is being sent, but the SOAP action is being specified outside of this because we are sending this through a HTTP post, right? So we are actually mixing some part of how this SOAP message should be handled by somebody with the HTTP information, which is part of the post that we are doing. Right, now we don't want to do that. Now the notion is we want to separate these two things cleanly. We just want to do a post independent of where this message is supposed to go to. I just want the host name in there. Of course, certainly I need a host if I'm going to do a post. There's no question about that. Therefore, I encapsulate everything else within the SOAP message itself, right? But SOAP will not understand the action part of it. So I have created certain new tags using WS addressing tags that have been specified for me, in which I specify this, right? So now I can specify this in any way. It can be HTTP, it can be an object reference, for example, that is sitting on the other side, and so on. It could be a serialized form of an object reference, and I could say that it is directed to that, and the action is actually a method on that particular object as opposed to an HTTP. Right. Now, the HTTP post that you do will simply be a normal HTTP post here. It has no SOAP information that is actually present in that. Right. So this we already know about. So we know that there are three different messaging behaviors that WSDL defines. There are actually four of them. We didn't go through the fourth one yesterday, the solicit response one. But we went through the one way, the request response and notification 2 days ago, right? So request response is two messages, then notification is only an output message that is coming back from the provider, right? So in the case of HTTP, when a response is made, we saw this, that it will be conveyed through an already opened HTTP channel. So it's not truly asynchronous in that case, right? So there is some client thread that is blocked waiting for this. What we really want is a scenario where the client sends off a message and then using, say, HTTP, but it is not going to wait for that open HTTP channel for the reply to come on. It's going to be a separate HTTP message that is directed back to the client, right? So this is completely asynchronous, and till the message comes along, it can be doing some other processing. The same client thread can be doing some other process, right? So this is asynchronous communication. How do you achieve that would be the question, right? And so WS addressing helps us do that by adding some of these tags. Now, when two independent messages are being sent, one from A to B and one from B to A, and it is meant to be a request reply scenario, right? You have to correlate these two messages somehow, right? We talked about this both yesterday and day before yesterday, right? That correlation between the different messages are needed, and so WS addressing actually formalizes how you can do that correlation, using the notion of a message ID and what it is, which other message it is related to, and so on, right? So we'll see examples of this. Okay, so here is the message. The basic SOAP message is, this is your SOAP header and this is your SOAP body that was there, right? Within the SOAP header, now we are adding some information which has to do with this notion of asynchronism that we want to achieve. Now, what are we adding here? We are adding the from address. We are saying that, you know, this is who is sending the message, and if you want to reply to this, please reply to, there's a listener that is waiting at this particular URL, right, for a message to come back, right? So the message that is going to come back is going to be coordinated in some way through this UID that is specified here, the message ID that is specified here. Right, so the message ID is going to be included in the, it's not exactly a reply message, it is another message that is coming back in the other direction, but it is in response to a message that I had sent in this direction. So there are two independent messages, right? This notion of an open HTTP channel we discussed on day one as well, I believe here, right? So we are not dependent on that open channel anymore, right? So because the response could take a long time to come back, and we don't want to hold that channel open. As a result of which we have to do the coordination. That coordination is being done through this ID, and then we are also saying, where do you send the message back, right? Because in the case of HTTP, what happens, you open a connection to the other side, right? Now the open connection, obviously there is a port on the client process that is opened as well in order to send the information. The port in the client process is implicit. You don't see it as a client. Only the listening port is usually seen and set up by the programmer. The client port is implicitly used in order to get the information back from the HTTP server, and then the information is processed back within the client. Right? Now there is no client port. Right, so this is a way of specifying that client port, saying send me back a message that I'm waiting for a reply at this place. And if there happens to be a problem, call me back at this place, is what I'm saying. Right, so if there's a fault as opposed to, of course, I can have the same thing, I don't have to have these two be separate, and I can process the exception at the listening port itself. But in this particular example, we are given these two. Just to illustrate the fact that this fault to tag that has been defined as part of WS addressing, allows you to split these two things out. And how I'm going to tie in the request and the reply is through using this UID. Right? Now you can, it's a very generic mechanism, as you can see, and this UID can actually be related to any message. So I want to tie a series of messages together, I can do that. But the typical usage of this would be that it's a request and a reply. Both have the same UID in some way. No, it's synchronous in the sense it is just doing a post, but I'm not waiting for the results of that post in here. That will just be an acknowledgement. That's not actually the result of the request that is being encapsulated in the SOAP, right? So this stock, get stock price of IBM is the request, but I'm not going to, the SOAP handler on the other side is not going to send a reply back via that HTTP channel that is open. That's just an acknowledgement.
By default, it says asynchronous.
Yeah, so this is how you would achieve asynchronous. By default, it is synchronous, right? If I did not put this block, if I didn't put this WSA block completely, what happens? I'm doing a post, I'm specifying some SOAP action, and that will return something, right? So the fact that I'm putting this block is indicating to the SOAP handler on the other side that I can call this person back later. Where do I call this person back, right? And when I call him back with the results, I have to include some reference so that the other person can correlate his request with the message that I'm sending. That's what's happening here. This is a port at which you can send me a message. Yeah, it's basically a place where there is a SOAP listener that is sitting there and waiting for SOAP messages to come back. Because the reply is also another SOAP message. Right? So just like you have an endpoint specification that exists on the SOAP server side, effectively now the client is also becoming a SOAP server. Right? Because the client has to be able to process SOAP messages that are coming back and make sense out of that. So both have to have SOAP server capabilities in this particular case.
It's just informing the port number to the server on the other side that the reverse response should be sent to the client. Now the client would be listening for the response.
At that particular location, which is the WS reply listener location.
So it's just informing the new port number.
Right.
My understanding is it's the same TCP port.
It is another TCP port. It is not the HTTP connection port that was initially opened to send the post. It is another port that I'm listening at. So I actually become a listener, which is different than just being a sender. That's all.
Only the channel will be different, but the
new
channel. Reply will be given.
Reply will be given, but it can come at any time. That's what I'm making, that's what I'm allowing for this.
It will be open now. It will be initiated by the server.
That's right. That's exactly correct. That's exactly right. So this channel would be initiated by the server and it can come at any time, which is the key. Since I'm listening here, it can come at any time.
So this is WS reply listener. I mean, this value would be automatically taken or whichever port is available? Or
No. You have to have the WS reply listener is a port. So when you say some HTTP, whatever, .tr/WS reply listener, that means you can invoke this particular port and send a SOAP message to this. Just like I'm doing the reverse direction by saying www.stock.org/get-stock-price. That's the thing in the forward direction. Right? So in other words, the other person will do a post, right, to this address, and as part of the post there will be a SOAP message.
That's SOAP action.
Yes. So endpoint references, we already seen this, the from reply to fault to etc. They're all the notion of endpoint references. So that has all of these properties. This is the schema for it. So it has an address, which is an URI that identifies where the endpoint is. We saw an example of that. That is this. Then it may have certain other properties. What is the port type? The policy associated with that particular endpoint. So even there may be authentication policies that may be specifiable for every endpoint that we set up. That's out there. So endpoint reference is separated from the actual service itself. So an endpoint reference element just looks like this. So here is the an example of a service, which is a stock code service, documentation, etc. An endpoint is, remember we had this notion of a port that we associated with a service when we wrote out our WSDL. Now we are saying that we are going to separate that information out into a structure that looks like this. I'm going to describe an endpoint in a more detailed way, right? And I'm going to then, instead of having a port, I'm going to associate that endpoint with this particular notion of a port that I had before. Right, I'm just going to allow you to specify that in a more detailed manner instead of just giving a port specification where I'm going to be listening to. Right? And the advantage here is that I will be able to give it certain other properties, descriptions, give it a name that I can use elsewhere. More importantly, I can associate a policy with that particular endpoint itself. Right? So anybody calling on this this endpoint would have to have some kind of an authentication certificate to come to. Would be an example of such a policy. Right. So these three notions already existed: address, service name, port name, and port type, which you specified in the WSDL document earlier. We now have the addition of a policy and certain reference properties. So the endpoint actually has to be attached to this particular service that I'm defining. Right, so that endpoint is specified separately. This diagram doesn't show that it is attached to that. This is just showing the separation of the service specification or the notion of the port that we had earlier along with the endpoint that is specified for it separately. Action, this we have seen earlier already, action with WSDL operations. We saw this in the very first slide of WSA as to how to include the action as part of the WSDL or the SOAP message, as opposed to have it be part of the HTTP header that is being sent, right? So this is very similar to the first one. The first one that we saw, the very first slide that we saw in WSA was showing a SOAP message. Now what this is showing is actually a WSDL file, and how do I associate the SOAP action with WSDL, right? The first one just showed the SOAP message itself and the HTTP header, and how do I include what was in the HTTP header as the action into the SOAP message. Here I am describing it as part of the WSDL itself. Here there are two different actions depending on the message itself, and every message can have an action associated with that. As opposed to this, where the operation itself is associated with a action, not the specific messages themselves. Right? That's the difference between this one and this slide. Okay, fault codes, I mean there are some default fault codes that are already there, like 404, 200, 220, etc. But I don't think, there are things that you can obviously add to this as well. And this would come back as a SOAP fault. The only thing you can specify is that if there was a SOAP fault somewhere along the way, it's a different endpoint to which the reply can come, and I will listen at that particular endpoint for fault processing alone.
What is the get code, and in that input message,
right,
there's a WSA call and action. In action, we have given a URL. What is get code here?
The get code is an input message that is coming. The input, so these are two different, it's going to be treated as an asynchronous message, asynchronous operation. So the input message will call on this particular point, right? So that is the action point. This is presumably trying to say that it is going to have a sequence of ticker symbols that have to process at this point.
Is it an operation or is it a thing we are calling?
Yeah, this is an action.
It's
an action link. It's an operation. So that will basically consume the input message. That's all that it is eventually doing. Right? So the output message also is associated with an action. This should really be the client URL that is extracted from the from field, or the reply to field rather, that is in the SOAP message that came in eventually, right? So that's how it should be, at least. I don't think this is completely right, because why would both of these be related to stock.org is the question. So I'm not sure this is 100% right. What I believe is that the output action would be something that would involve sending a message back to the client at some reply to message, reply to URL that has been included in the WSA field, right?
So when the client, any client would be calling this operation get last rate price.
Right.
So what, these two are going to be argument to that operation.
Not two.
One is the argument, one is the return.
Yeah.
So, only one argument, get rate in price input, and the other one is get rate price output, would be the output. Why are we associating this WSA colon action attribute with the message here? That's what I'm not understanding.
Well, what we're trying to do is to separate, or see what happened, we have to compare it to this. What we're trying to do here is that we are saying the get trade price has an action that is associated with it, right? That you call get trade price. What the next slide is trying to say is we can separate these out into the processing of the input and the returning of the output. Separate these two things out. Right? These two are tied here basically. This was the action, this was the input, and this was the output associated with that action. This slide is just trying to show that you can separate these two and have two separate actions associated with processing the input and sending the output back. That's all. Right? And that would be required if you are doing, if you are processing this in an asynchronous manner, as opposed to a the first one is more of a synchronous request reply scenario, right? Where you will hit this particular URL, right? And this particular URL will have a SOAP body which has this stock quote type, right? Eventually, that is big. Pardon? Now this is one action. Right. This is this particular box is one action corresponding to one operation of getting the trade price for some set of ticker symbols that is being sent. That's all. This is what you normally would expect to see. Right. This is what you're used to seeing. This is the one he's saying that makes sense, which is why the reason being we are used to seeing this. There is one action that is associated with an operation that is taking some input and returning an output. So transactions. How many of you are familiar with the concept of a transaction? All must be, right? So with respect to databases, transactions has something called asset properties that it provides, right? The same notion is provided, but it becomes particularly relevant to distributed systems when there are many components, each one of which can fail independently, right? So there are many web services, for example. You saw that Beeple that you wrote out yesterday, it was contacting three different web services. Let's say these three web services were running on three different nodes altogether. Everything was running on the same node in the example you did yesterday. And what happens with this decentralization when you start pushing things out and distributing them is that different nodes can fail, right? So if there is a single Beeple instance that is running across these different nodes and one of the nodes fails, then how do you deal with it? Right now you don't have any way of dealing with it unless you have some kind of a transactional coordination that is taking place. So everybody is referring to a transactions coordinator, and we'll see how that is done in terms of the architecture, right? What transactions basically give you is the ability to achieve atomicity, finally. So either the entire process executes or make it appear as if no part of the process has executed at all, right? In other words, don't process half of it and then stop processing is what we want to ensure. So that's the notion of atomicity. And consistency, isolation, durability, it means exactly the same thing as it means with respect to databases as well. In the case of databases, for atomicity, what it means there is that if I'm going to change multiple tables or modify multiple rows, then make it appear as if all the changes took place with respect to the operations I'm doing on these database tables or not. In the case of distributed systems, I may be actually hitting physically disparate servers that are sitting wherever. Right. So atomic transactions can usually be either committed or it can be rolled back or aborted, as they say. And if it is committed, then durability has to be guaranteed. In other words, every change that has been made during the course of the transaction has to be made durable or made available after the period of the transaction is over. Right. In the case of aborted, every change that has been made up till the point that we called the abort has to be rolled back. Okay. Atomic transactions are good in the case of databases, right? So it's usually going to work because they're short-lived transactions, as they're called. It happens in the space of at most a couple of seconds, right? Not more than that. But in the case of the kinds of business processes that you saw yesterday, it may happen over the course of several days, right? The business process you saw yesterday, of course, was a flow-through process where there was no human involvement, right? So the kind of workflow you saw yesterday had no human involvement, and therefore everything was happening pretty quick, right? So as soon as you call the JSP to invoke the business process or the Beeple, then the result would come right back. right? That's actually a short-lived transactions, but typically business processes are long-lived transactions, right? And how do transactions work? They work by holding on to certain resources in order to ensure that other people will not be able to modify the resources when this transaction is alive. So if transaction one starts and it starts modifying a table, it will typically lock some rows of the table or the table itself, depending on what are the semantics that you're going to give it, you know, row level locking, table level lock, so on. Now, in the case of long-lived transactions, you can't lock everything and keep it, because if the transaction is going to take several days, then there's no point. It's going to be a problem there, and we have to deal with it very differently. So, which is why we have this notion of WS transactions, right? It's actually a suite of specifications because it works along with Beeple itself as well. It eventually has to work with business processes. What we're interested in this suite are two transactional models that are specified, one for short-lived and one for long-lived. There could be short-lived transactions even with web services being deployed, right? And one which is more the business activity model, which are long-lived transactions. Okay, so we won't necessarily go through this. It's just the coordination to say that there is one framework for all of this. So what's happening here is that there are transaction aware web services. Those are the ones that are being described in green here, right? A client application is the one that kicks off a transaction that cuts across these services. There may be many different participants that are out there. And then how we achieve this notion of atomicity is through a notion of somebody called a transaction coordinator, right? So how many of you have used Tuxedo here? Anybody has used Tuxedo, which is a transaction manager, not relating to this, but it's a different product that existed before. Tuxedo, which also was from BEA Systems, right? So it's a transaction manager. What these transaction managers do is that every operation that has to be done has to go through them. So they are keeping track of how much has been done, and so in case an abort has to take place, what is it that has to be rolled back, right? That is being kept track of by somebody, and that somebody is a transaction coordinator. Same thing happens here, not really very different. Or this is the Java API for that, so let's not worry about it at this point in time. It's called JAX-TX. Okay. So the different players that are involved in one of these transactions is, so the first of all, there's the coordinator who is the central player, and he drives what is called a two-phase commit. Presume you're familiar with the two-phase commit, right? So those quick cap of the two-phase commit is that in the first phase, the transaction coordinator will ask all the participants to find out if they are prepared to commit or not. Right? If everybody is prepared to commit, then it will issue a commit command in the second phase and go ahead and commit on that. and then if one of them is not prepared to commit, it will do an abort or a rollback. Right? So that is the participant. They can vote to abort or they can vote to prepare to commit. Right? Completion initiator is the client. Right? So the client who says commit or abort in the first place. And that signal goes to the coordinator, and the coordinator coordinates the two-phase commit protocol. Those are the different players. This picture is actually not completely right, so I will not go through this. There's a correct version of this picture a little later that I will show you. So if you have this on your slide, please strike it off. I should have removed this yesterday. The reason why this is not entirely right is that from completing, if you are going to abort, you will not go to end. You will have to first go back to aborting and then end. Okay. So these are the different operations of the coordinator, right? So it has a commit operation, it has a rollback operation, it has an error operation, etc. So the participant's completion service has to basically say it has committed or not, or it is aborted or not, or there was an error during this process. So this is the whistle for the participant. Right, and the client API for this obviously just says commit or abort. So that is the initiator, as we called it earlier. Right. One of the things that you can do with WS transactions is you may already have different transactional systems that are out there. Presumably you will, because you're not going to start from scratch. There are legacy systems. You might have heard of KICS, right? CICS from IBM. It is also a transaction manager similar to Tuxedo, competing project. So you may have, for example, during the acquisition, let's say it's a big company, it acquires different companies. One company was working with KICS, one company was working with Tuxedo. Now, how do I actually coordinate a transaction that is going across a KICS system and across a Tuxedo system? Right, so you need to have some kind of a standard, and the WS transaction would be a good standard to try and do this kind of a coordination. Right, so in other words, the transaction coordinator for WS transactions will talk to the two transaction coordinators for KICS and Tuxedo, who, whichever else is there, whichever other product is there in that space, and will do the two-phase commit with respect to those two transaction coordinators, who will then drive individual two-phase commits down to the lower levels, right? So it's a hierarchical two-phase commit solution can be formed out of already existing enterprise applications. This is, I think, the correct picture of the two-phase commit that replaces the original picture. You start with active, and once you are active, you go to preparing. So if you are prepared to commit, then you enter this stage. If you are not prepared to commit, you start aborting at that point in time. Right? Of course, you can start aborting even when you are prepared to commit. Something goes wrong, you can abort. So you can abort at any time is what it's trying to say. Of course, if it is read-only, it doesn't matter if you have not changed any data at all. Then you will simply go to end. And then you're in committing state, and then you finally end that particular transaction. Right? So this is phase one of your two-phase commit. This is the coordinator generated phase, and then there is phase two, which is the participant generated.
So there is a state transition for the participant.
For two-phase commit.
For the participant.
Yes. I don't think we need to go through this. There's a lot more complexity to transactions than we would even want to think about. This is actually showing a message sequence diagram for a two-phase commit protocol. Which involves a database web service in this particular case. There are 10 steps that it is going to go through in order to actually achieve this two-phase commit. First, some transactional activity is created by the application itself, right? A transactional activity could be an abort or a commit call that is being made. Right? The coordinator service returns, well, transactional activity is actually the beginning of the transaction. It's not an abort or a commit. So the way that it works is that, let me just write this down. So there's some client code, and the client code would basically say begin transaction. When you say begin transaction, the step that is happening here is that the coordination service, which is the coordinator, transaction coordinator, will return a coordination context. All right. So the reason why the context is required is because the context captures some kind of a unique identifier for the coordinator that says that there may be many parallel instances of transactions going on. Many transactions are going on in parallel. So I will want to identify everything associated with one transaction. Right? And then this does some transactional operations, let's say op 1, op 2, etc. Every operation is going to be sent the context through the coordinator to the participant. Let's say this is participant 1, participant 2. Let's say op 1 will go, it will carry the context to participant 1, who will then identify the fact that it did some operation as part of that specific transaction. So if it has to roll back, it has to identify what it has to roll back, right? Same thing with respect to op 2. So the context is used in every operation that is done, and finally you will do a commit or an abort at that point. Right? So let's say there is some exception that is raised. If an exception is raised, then I will do an abort. If an exception is not raised, then I will do a commit. That's what the client code looks like. Okay, so this is the first step where it is actually returning the coordination context itself. Right? So the identifier here happens to be something called activity 1, that is a coordination context. Okay. In the second step, okay, so this is fine, the coordinator reference is returned. and some operation is performed on a web service, which is what I just said, after the begin, some operation, some set of operations are performed. Any one of these operations would look like this. But the coordination context information actually has to be given there, which is the this activity one tag that was gotten in the first step, if you notice, right, which is the coordination context, is going to be part of any activity there. So instead of just doing a SOAP operation, which in this particular case it's a debit account SOAP operation, I will include certain header information having to do with the transactions that says that this SOAP operation that I'm performing is part of a transaction identified by a transactional context that I'm including in the header, right? So that's what this is doing. It's of type atomic transaction. Then finally, there is the service registers a two-phase commit. So let's say that some set of operations, only one of which was shown in this sequence, and finally it registers a two-phase commit. So it says what is the coordinator address for that particular two-phase commit. Right. The web service is now going to return a result that also includes the thing. So the debit account result is being returned as a separate SOAP message, which is why it can have a header as well. Right. Then what? Okay, so here is where the application is calling the commit itself. So it is a completion that is happening. The port type is completion and the message is commit. Remember the different messages that were available as part of the coordinator interface. So this message is going to be sent to the coordinator itself to say that we want to now commit this transaction that we had opened earlier. Right? Pardon?
Case of rollback.
Huh. You can, the message would be a rollback in that case. It's completion with rollback, right? So it has to complete both ways. So your client code would really be what would drive a commit versus rollback is successful completion versus some exception raised during your processing. That's the standard client code, right? So the coordinator then starts the two-phase commit by asking people to prepare. So it will actually, so this is a participant protocol service. So every participant is sent this particular message to say, you know, you prepare for a commit. What is not shown here, which would be shown, is that the transaction context, remember that something one, activity one. Yeah, so this transaction context is also included. I've not shown this here necessarily. So the prepare is sent, but the transaction context has to be sent as part of every SOAP message in the header. Otherwise, you cannot identify what is it that you are preparing to commit. Right? That identifies which transaction, because the same participant could be involved in multiple transactions at the same time. Right? And you could have made certain changes on behalf of each transaction. So that context also has to be included. That's not shown here. Right? The participant actually sends back a message saying prepared. Right. Commit. Right. So this is part of the coordinator protocol. The port type is a two-phase commit. So the web service that is capable of participating in a transaction will have to support the two-phase commit port type. Will have to support. That's what we meant by a transaction-aware web service in the diagram that we showed earlier. That's what it means. So apart from whatever port type, its own operations it's going to export, it will also have to support. So it's suppose, let's say it's a bank account kind of a web service. So it will support the debit, credit, transfer, whatever operations, plus the two-phase commit has to be a port type that it exports. Then the participant then sends committed, the usual two-phase commit, and at that point the protocol ends. Right. So it's 11 steps in order to, these 11 steps of course include everything from beginning the transaction, then the several operations that are done, and then the final two-phase commit protocol itself. Right.